you're doing, who you belong, if you're bona fide people. So a church is formed by a group of people coming together and believing in the same thing, signed up to it, that we're members of this particular organization with this name. Because in years gone by, a lot of churches committed crimes in the name of religion. Yes? Like the American big the Moody's and the Last Day Saints.
Latter Day Saints.
So they committed tax fraud, and that's why America locked down and British government would not give anybody any license if they associated with America. In the 70s. Yeah. Because remember, I don't remember the struggles we had to get charity number passed.
It
cost us a lot of money. We had to employ a lawyer to fight for a corner to get it. Because and that's why Mount Zion was, this movement was founded, yeah, and prior to that, the group in the Abbey, which was run by Pastor Edwards, were connected to United States of America and Jamaica. But in 1971, when the vision of mine reached a stage wherein we were seeking for charitable status, they told us they won't give it to us because the Moonies and Latter-day Saints was having a problem with their tax. So then we had the option, and that's when Seventh-day Church of God, UK International Conference, was founded and formed, because we had to write our own constitution and we had to set up our whole organization with this name, Mount Zion Seventh-day Church of God, UK International Conference, under my leadership and my vision and family. So, having done all of this, in the studies that I did in, I did 4 years, nearly 4 years, so minus four from this one, 96, 95, 96, I went to, I did the Denver studies. In that study, this is where I was taught where the church began. But what they taught me did not include the charismatic side of things that I'm trying to let all the people under my care and association and incorporated situation learn. See, because Denver did not taught me or teach me about clapping hands. They did not. They didn't teach me that. They go down there. If you go to Denver, Colorado tomorrow on the Sabbath day, you will find that they worship just like the Adventist worship. They don't have the clapping and praise the Lord, hallelujah, at the headquarters of Church of God Seventh-day. Yeah?
Is that a predominantly black church? The Denver, Colorado church, is it much black? Is there a lot of black people?
No. To be honest, headquarters or ministry is predominantly white setting. So the difference between, that's what I was trying to, I plan to teach today, that the how we come to have Church of God Seventh-day, our Mount Zion Seventh-day Church of God, our Sabbath keeping Seventh-day Church of God, or, you know, whatever. So in this, you will find the family tree of the Adventists. From the Adventists, in the 18th century, after the Great Depression, because of slavery and the Civil War, because it's after slavery, then you have the Civil War, which end up with a great the West, right? Miller, Miller. You tell me I have to go over this again. William Miller, when he saw, because when there is a need and depression on people, religion is kind of the closest antidote for those things. You know that slavery drove people to God, because that was their only hope. And that's why the American black people sing those gospel songs and worship the way they did. So our charismatic type of worship emanates from black Americans, which drifted to the Caribbean countries, but more so for Jamaica, which this man, who was an Adventist, Charles J. Ellis, who was the overseer or bishop, he came to Jamaica from Panama, right? And he was not happy with the Adventist movement. So he went and fellowship with the Pentecostal church at Morgan, I can't remember the name of the road, but then Morgan Street, that's what I mean. It's in the notes. And basically, that's where we're at. So from Ellis, several churches split from Ellis, like the Bryson, the Dykes, and the McFarlane,
and of course Wallace,
and all of them came away from 64 North Street, which was the headquarters of Church of God Seventh Day in Jamaica. Right? So from just like you see the layout here of all the groups who split away from an Advent movement, then you have the Sabbath Advent, which is the Church of God, and the Seventh Day Adventist. So the Advent movement, which was under under Miller, right? And all the disappointment and all of this and all of that, yes, you have as a result of that the Seventh Day Adventist and the Church of God Seventh Day. Yeah? And you also have, watch this, how do we have the movement we have? From the Advent movement, not Seventh Day Adventist, watch this. From the Advent movement, you also have the Sunday Adventist, meant that Sunday worshippers or Sunday knowledge people are also Adventists, because what is Adventist? The second coming, the second return of Jesus Christ. So every person who believes in Jesus return, we are Adventists. Am I making sense?
Yes.
Everybody that call upon Jesus' name and believe in his second coming, we are all Adventists. The Baptists are Adventists. So we are Baptists too, because we're baptized.
Yeah.
Your New Testament. Because we believe in the New Testament. Are you, Uncle, come on.
We're the Church of God.
And we are Church of God. But we believe in God.
So, Bishop,
I
was going to ask you about that, because I do realize, I heard somewhere that we have taken on so
No Sabbath keeping church has ever written songs in books. The songs that we that Denver, other organization, that we use, we do it by license.
Yes.
Because we don't write nothing.
Yes. We don't write the song. We don't have
to. We don't do them. And you know the reason why we don't because we don't like study. We're lazy.
You mean Church of God?
Church of God, Sunday, out of whatever, Mount Zion, Sunday. We're lazy people. We don't like study. That's
sure.
Why. The Adventists, even the Catholic Church, people have problem with Catholic. Catholic, because we are Catholic, because we are worldwide. But we are not Roman Catholic.
Okay.
So we are Catholic as well.
Yes,
because we are worldwide. Catholic means universal.
Bishop,
you see the Adventists, my mom and my dad, they used to go to Church of God. And they change and go to Adventist. And they don't, what we do in here, they don't read. They mostly deal with the Bible.
They mostly study.
You cannot fool them on the Bible. Yeah.
So, folks, all I want to do, and ever want to do, since 2000, when I was graduating from Denver, I just want to share. I remember Pastor Bennett, when I came, he said to me, he said, Bishop, just take your time with us. Because it was foreign. When I came back, I was looked upon as the reindeer. Because folks did not understand what I was talking about. But since I graduated, this is what I want to do. And I ask the question, why do we do the things we do? That's what the lecture meant to have been today. Why do we worship the way we do? And where did the movement of Seventh-day worshiping begin? Have you ever given that a thought, anybody?
We always learn that it came through the Adventists, and we learn about Miller and Ellen G. White, and that they met with some Orthodox Jews, and that's how they had knowledge of the Sabbath. And as a result, they start a Sabbath movement. The Advent movement became Seventh-day Adventists under Ellen G. White. And then from that, there are groups who believe in the Pentecostal movement.
But they didn't tell you where the Pentecostal movement
came. No, I don't know where that.
The
reform started.
That's right.
I forgot what they called it at the time. And then that became even more popular. When they have what we call Azusa Street revival, that breaks up where people become charismatic. The charismatic movement begins and give birth to UPC, United Pentecostal, and the apostolic group, where people now start to believe in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and all of that. And that the gifting, healing, the gift of the Spirit, as all of that movement started like in the late 18th to 19th century.
Yeah. So if you look at the revivalist people, that emanates back to slavery.
Yes.
And
if you
see how the African people behave, right, that revivalism. Right. But when so that type of charisma of actually want to free up yourself, and when you equate that with religion, that's why this neutralize it in a way that you have revivalists. Because the reason why I'm so into this type of thing, my great first interest in church was revival.
Because revivalists, that movement is actually deep rooted in Africa.
Yes.
Spiritism.
Yes.
That kind of spiritism put on religion when it came to Jamaica.
Yeah.
And when it put on religion, and they start to make themselves religious, to also make themselves popular, to make the movement popular.
Yeah.
Is that the Rastafarian?
Yeah.
In order to make Rastafarian popular, they pull all that from Africa,
yeah,
using Haile Selassie as their object of worship.
So, having said that, I think the lecture has not been able to go on, brethren. I meant to finish now. And I haven't gone into any notes. The other handouts here, which I meant to give everybody. But I have not done any lecture this morning. I've been asked a little bit to give a little short synopsis of what the lecture was going to be all about.
See, it was definitely going to be interesting.
Yes.
Yeah, it was definitely going to be.
I have a question. Do you have an idea of what was the difference between the Seventh-day Adventist and the Sunday Adventist, Pastor?
Mm.
Because from what you have given here is that we have the Sabbath keeping Adventist.
Yes,
and the Sunday keeping. I wonder what was the sort of difference between them. Is it only because
because both were deep rooted in eschatology.
Yeah.
Eschatology, they were both deep rooted in that.
Yeah.
So they derived the name Advent.
That's right.
Second Advent.
Because
but the Sabbath was the difference.
Yeah.
Okay.
In the Millerites movement, Miller was able, under the Depression, because when people are going through our times, they look to God for some type of refuge. So Miller promised the second coming of Jesus Christ. Yeah? And when the last episode, or the last showdown, was, let me tell you here, in the 1840, between 1831 to 1844, William Miller promised the doctrine of the second advent of Jesus Christ. Right? Watching? We're streaming.
Wow. You didn't do anything wrong.
No,
that's
where I'm. No. What are you doing? Put something up that the lecture has to be turned into the back on the center. It's going to be time. Yeah. Can you put something up? Tell them something. Yeah. I'll just say something here that they can hear as well. Right. Yeah. Good. What I'm saying, folks, those who are watching, we meant to have a lecture today, but of course, my audience did not come on time, and we have a time frame that we have to finish. I suppose we'll finish the lecture at 12:30, and by until about 12, no one was here. So those who were here asked me to do a short synopsis. I haven't gone through any notes. I haven't gone through my plan
to have gone through with it. But they asked me to say a little talk, to what you've been listening to. But if you want to hear the real lecture, then will you please tune in on Sabbath? What date Sabbath coming will be? Can somebody tell me? What date will that be?
30th.
The what?
30th.
No. Next Sabbath coming.
Twenty-seventh.
Instead of having a Sabbath school lesson, then I'm going to take the church in this lecture. So tune in. At 10:15, Sabbath the 27th, and you will get the real Monty. I will go through. It's going to be one of the most dynamic, interesting lessons or studies that you're going to hear. I don't believe I know it all, but for what I know, you will know too. God bless you. Sorry, we've got to cut that. It was not meant for you to hear that bit, but you heard it, so it's good.
Thank you. All right, now we're not streaming. Let's wrap this up now. We're probably not going to have to switch down.
Sorry, can I just make an observation? Don't you think sometimes over years, people like to have a difference, and we look for difference because it's a natural order for man to always have something that they is unique to them. So don't you think that could be one reason why Saturday church came about? Because within his Sunday church,